Is there anybody here today who was not here last night? Raise your hands. So you all know what we are talking about when we discuss accessing the self, finding out our own self by means which are practical, safe, and consistent with our lifestyles, consistent with our belief systems. What I am going to share with you today is not a cult or a religion or a particular tantric yoga. It's not anything that should take you away from your own belief system, from your own religion, from your own lifestyle. You have to make a very minor modification in order to successfully practice this system of accessing your own self. And that also, modification is necessary so that you can have better results from this practice of knowing oneself. As I mentioned yesterday, we have been greatly confused about this notion of self. Self, as commonly understood, means ourself, the one that questions, the one that asks, who is the self? The self is the thinking self. The self is the one that is in a physical body sitting here, or in my physical body standing here, and that's the self. How can we then start talking of knowing the self, discovering a self, as if it is something foreign to us or away from us? Things get more confused when we start using other adjectives to describe that self, like the super self, the higher self, the over self. We have to look for our over self. We have to look for our super self. We have to look for the true self, as if that is separate from the self that we are experiencing now. This confusion that we have to look out for something different from ourselves has been a stumbling block in the realization of the self. Whenever we have created a wall between our own reality and our own seeking, we have never been able to reach our objective. That is why it is so difficult to find God. Because if God is our own true self, how can we separate ourselves from God and then start searching for Him? But we have somehow, for centuries, put God somewhere else. People openly talk about it. Let's pray to God. They look up as if He's somewhere up in the skies, up in the heavens. We talk as if, we point out, as if there's a relationship between this one and that one. This dichotomy between our true self and our immediate self creates a barrier to knowing the self. Because when we create this dichotomy, then we are automatically creating an artificial self, a self that is not real. We are creating a shadow self, and we are trying to say that the shadow self is more real than the self that is seeking. So far, so good. But what is the answer? If we start saying, no, the self that is seeking is the same self that you are going to find, then what are we searching for? If the self that seeks is the self that is sought, where is the search? There is no search left after that. One has to be very careful about understanding this whole business of there being only one self, then who is seeking who? Who is the seeker and who is the sought? If there is only one self. Also, when we know that except the self, nobody can seek. And except the self, nobody can be sought. Who is seeking who? And why do we need seeking in that case? The mystics, the perfect living masters, the adepts in this science, who have been able to practice self-realization, who have been able to overcome this hump of dichotomy between a self that has to seek and the self that has to be found, have come up with some very practical propositions. They have said that the self is only one, but has the habit of mistaking its identity with its cover. That's how they explained it. If I wear a shirt and I call myself a shirt, then eventually I may say, this is a shirt. Then I have the right to say, this is a shirt, who is wearing it? It is a mistaken identity. It's a misidentification with a cover that can create a problem. So the adepts tell us that we have misidentified ourselves with the covers upon consciousness, and therefore we have lost immediate awareness of the consciousness that proceeds within those covers and gives them life and makes them the cover for the self. The outermost cover, apparently, is this body, physical body. This physical body in which consciousness is housed, in which consciousness is operating, this physical body appears to be the first external cover with which we identify. And this identification is very well programmed. It is very well executed. We leave no loopholes. As a new soul, new consciousness, a consciousness which we call life, comes into a new body and enters the mother's womb in the fifth month of pregnancy during quickening and makes that body independently vibrant and alive, from that moment we begin to feel there's a self in that body. When the child is born, the self is born. So the identification starts from there. The child is named, that is the name of that person, the person who will grow up, speak and seek. The one who will seek the truth is the person whose name was given at that time. The name was obviously given to the body. We did not even care to examine if the soul, the consciousness, the entity that got into the body had an earlier name. Was there any good reason to change the name? Was there any good reason to consider what should be the name in the light of the previous experience of that conscious being who came into that body? We have no knowledge. So we allow that human physical body to grow up as the self. Not only that, the self is encouraged in that body to regard all associations arising from the body as the associations of the self. Such as, these are my hands, this is my body, these are my friends, this is my father, this is my mother, these are my children, these are my parents, these are my friends, these are my associates, this is my business, this is my car, this is my house. And the whole life goes on associating all these possessions with the word my, as if they belong to the self, the person who claims to have them. And yet they are all associated with the body. None of these things, neither the parents, nor the children, nor the cars, nor the homes, had ever belonged to the living force that occupies the body. They've all been registered in the name of the body. The name itself given to that person has been given to that body. And yet we encourage this misidentification of the self with the body, and so the self grows, saying, this is me, my name is so and so. We give the name given to our body as the name of the self. So the self which is immortal, the self which is a continuous stream of consciousness, which has never ended and never begun. The continuous stream of immortal consciousness, which has gone through a small experience of a human body, is cut off into a very limited experience of the self. That this was born, will grow up and die. The whole self will die, including that soul, mind, everything, consciousness. We programmed it like this. We cultivated it like this. Having cultivated like this, we have created the greatest confusion ever possible. We tell people, find yourself. They're finding the self in terms of body awareness, in terms of where they are in relation to other beings. And all their world, the entire world of the self, gets confined to the world that can be created and experienced by the physical body. The physical body, just a piece of flesh and tissue and bone and other cells, this physical body has very limited capability. It is so dense and gross, has weight, is tied down by gravity, has problems of growing too weight, having to go to weight loss centers, having problems of overeating, problems of taste and touch and smell and relationships and soured relationships. All this is coming from the body. All these problems that are coming from the body, we are saying these are my problems. Because I have no notion of any other problem except the problems of the body, which have now become the problems of myself. This is a very, very distorted experience of the self. And because of these continuous experiences of the body, we create a world which is based only upon the capacity of the body. If the eyes fixed in the face of the body, physical body, can see, what we see is all that exists for us. If these eyes are too dense to see everything, these eyes cannot see X-rays, these eyes cannot see alpha or gamma rays, these eyes cannot see lots of vibrations going on. Right now through this room, million calls have just passed through in electromagnetic vibrations. None of us saw anything. They just passed. They all programmed. We never saw anything. Why? Because these eyes are so dense. And yet we say, oh, we are the only one sitting in this room. Nothing else is happening. We are confining the existence of this universe to that which can be experienced by the sensory systems of a physical body. And we confine the whole world to what we can experience. And that is our world. So we are the makers of a world which is very limited. It's limited by the capacity of our own bodies. And we do not know the whole world. We know very little. We meet very few people. We travel very little. Some people travel more. Others read about travel. Some just conjecture, speculate. All the conjecture and speculation and actual travel put together gives a very small fraction of the knowledge even of the physical world. And yet that is all we know of the physical world. Our physical world is created based upon the experience, limited experience of a physical body's sensory organs. It's a great shame that we have reduced the world to such a small size just because of the limitation of one of our covers, the physical body, through which we are now experiencing life or consciousness. These mystic adepts tell us that at least once in one's lifetime, one should find out if the self has something more than merely the physical body. At least once, one should find out. Because if you find out once, at least you'd break all these notions that the world is what you can see and experience. You will also break the notions that the body alone is the self. At least once, you should see, if this body were not there, would you still be there? And what would you be doing? And what would be your capabilities? Would you be able to see more of the world or less of the world? Would you see another world or the same world? Do you still continue to exist as a conscious being with the same feeling of sense as you have now? Or does it change? At least once you should be able to access a self without the physical body. They come up with another suggestion. They say it's not very difficult to do it because most of us do it every night. We go to sleep and become unconscious of this body. And when we are unconscious of the body, we create another world. And we call it the dream world. And we move about in the dream world, and that is not the same body. When we walk in a dream, sleeping in the bed, walking in a dream, we are not walking with this body, but a similar body. And yet, while the dream is lasting, that body looks real. And when we wake up, it becomes unreal. And this one becomes real. When we go to sleep and dream, this one is unknown. We become unconscious. That one becomes real. But whichever body becomes real or unreal, the self remains the same and equally real. That's the point they make. When you go to sleep and have a dream, it's the same self dreaming. Have you noticed any change in the self? When you wake up, you can say, I dreamt like this, irrespective of the body. Not only that, supposing you had a dream that you were a bird, a little dove, beautiful white dove, and you flew out of the window in a dream. What a strange dream. And you wake up and say, what a beautiful dream. I dreamt I was a bird flying out of a window. Anybody can question, how can you be a bird? You have no feathers, you don't have wings, you don't look like a bird. You shouldn't say, I flew out of a window. You should say, I, in my dream, saw a bird flying out of a window. But you never saw a bird flying out of a window. You flew out of a window. You never saw any bird. You knew you flapped your wings and flew out. A total change in your body appearance, in capabilities, in being able to fly, did not change the nature of the self. The same self asserts, I was a bird and flew out. The same self wakes up and say, I had a dream, I was a bird and flew out. The self did not change, the body changed. Mystic adepts say, if this can happen to an experience like a dream, surely there must be something which could give you an insight into what would happen if you were more awake and not more sleepy than you are in a dream. You have to go to sleep to have a dream. What about being super awake to have a state of experience, not a dream, not wakefulness, but super wakefulness, as if it is more awake than we are now? What would happen? Well, one of the ways is, if we die in this body, we'll find out automatically what happens. If we still survive and go about, we'll try and run and tell the people, we were fools, we thought the body was everything, but we are still there. The body is dead, but our ghosts are still surviving. We are running around, but nobody can listen, nobody can see us. Nobody can see us because we never saw anybody after they died. So we have no communication. Mystic adepts say, don't wait for that time. Don't wait for dying in order to find out if you exist besides your physical body. Die while you are living in the physical body. And experience dying while living. Experience what would happen to you and to your consciousness if you did not have the body, but you had full awakening and full consciousness. So this business of accessing the self starts from there. If you can have an experience of full wakeful consciousness and do not have the experience at the same time of your physical body, what do you feel like? Who are you? At least that will be an experience of the self other than this body. Mystic adepts say, all seekers should at least once have that experience, so that this deep-rooted misidentification with the physical body as being the only self is removed. This deep-rooted distortion is corrected from our perspective, and we are able to see that consciousness and soul and spirit is more than merely the metabolic forces going on in a living body, in a living cell. It's more than that. It concerns consciousness and not merely the process of change that takes place by metabolic process. They want us to experience that personally, not on hearsay, not on somebody else's statement, not that guru said so, therefore I know it. That is no knowledge. A knowledge based upon some other person's experience is not your knowledge at all. Only that knowledge is valid on the spiritual path, which is your own knowledge, which you've gone through yourself. That is why these mystic adepts have been emphasizing the importance of getting this knowledge by personal experience. Now, this business of dying while living sounds, for those who have done it, it sounds very normal and automatic. It's like a good, deep, deep trance meditation. Those who have not done it, it looks very spooky and very weird that you should be dying while you are still alive. Why do it? Why don't you enjoy life? Why don't you enjoy what you have? What's the big sense of dying from what you already have? Find out something which is unknown. But the truth is, we do not die to find out something that is just of academic curiosity. We are doing this in order to see if we can solve our immediate problems of unhappiness and loneliness arising out of our misidentification of the self with our body. We are trying to do this to find immediate application for this knowledge, not for the sake of an academic knowledge, oh, I found out there is a soul. So what? Question is, did it make you a happier person? Did it make other people whom you knew happier people? Did your association generate general happiness? Did you inspire people to higher levels of happiness? If you didn't, what good is it? There were many metaphysical philosophers who came in the past who were called the despondent philosophers, the philosophers of despair, pessimism. They said, this is a hopeless situation. We can do nothing. We are trapped. There is no way to get. They cried. They made everybody else cry. They made even happy people unhappy. What is their great contribution? Even though they saw how the mind of a human being can get into traps again and again, how the mind of a human being can create a spider's web from which it can never get out, they saw all that and shared with us, but they made us unhappy with that knowledge. That knowledge never helped anybody. It didn't help them either. They hoped and prayed when they can get rid of that knowledge. But they couldn't. They were too trapped in their own knowledge. Mystic adepts say, we are not concerned with these absolute academic studies. We are concerned with something that is good here and hereafter. Something that we can use right now to generate happiness for ourselves and for others around us. And for that purpose, they say, look at the possibility of finding the true nature of yourself so that knowing who you are not blinded by the relationships of your body into believing that all the miseries that are coming to you because of the body and its relationships are real and are your own miseries. That you can make at least the distinction between a bodily misery and a misery of the self. At least you can draw a distinction between what is afflicting the body and what is afflicting yourself. To that end, they recommend that if you don't want to die while living in a jiffy, do it in a stages. Do it in convenient installment plans. Do it in a way that suits you. See how much time and attention you can invest and follow a procedure according to your own pattern of lifestyle, your own time patterns, the attention you can devote to it. You fix your own regime for it. They're not very particular. They don't want to make it into a ritual. One of the things these mystic adepts who were experiencers of reality, experiencers of the real self, experiencers of the self other than the covers upon the self. These mystic adepts were able to tell us that merely shrouding ourselves with mysteries does not give us anything. It only gives us superstitions. We are so accustomed to being duped by superstition, so accustomed to duped by something mysterious. We can't see, that person can see, so must be a master, must be something. We are being misled all the time. These adepts who have awakened themselves and want to awaken us do not want to repeat the same thing. They do not want to create more superstitions. They want to take us out of superstitions. They do not want to create more rituals for us. They want to take us out of the existing rituals. They want us to see things plainly with our own eyes and experience plainly with our own consciousness what the truth about our own self is, not somebody else's self. Therefore, it's a very straightforward deal they offer us. You, at your own space, in your own way, depending upon your own lifestyle, access your own self and find out its nature. Having found it, readjust your priorities and values and become happy, because you will find you were totally misled about the sanctity of some relationships, the sanctity of some attachments, the great eagerness and greed and avarice for possessing things of this physical world. Those were all distorted values because you did not know any higher wealth existed for the self that is beyond the body. So this particular approach is not confined to any particular group. The message of these mystic adepts is for all humanity. Every person, a child of 5 years to an old man of 100 years, or an old woman of 100 years. I don't want to sound that I'm only taking the name of men, women, men, children of any sex, any caste, creed, nationality, color. It doesn't matter at all. This path which they open for us for self-realization is open for every person on this planet Earth, and is for the whole of humanity. There is no restriction. It's not for any particular group. They say, you stay on doing what you are doing. Just go and find, if you have been misidentifying yourself with the body and calling it as the only self, or do you know something more about the living force consciousness that operates in the body? Now, as I said, the steps towards finding out if you are more real than the body is to take the body apart and see if you are still there. That's a risky business. If you kill the body and you are not there, you don't come back. It's one way. But you can do another thing, which is safe. And that is, instead of killing the body, become unaware of the body. And that's the simple technique they teach. If you can find a way by which you can become unaware of the body and still remain aware of your own conscious self, you found the answer. How do we become unaware of the body and yet remain aware of our own conscious self? We have this endowment in us of an extremely valuable kind which helps us to do this. And that endowment is called the power of human attention. That we have a capacity to attend to something. That we have a capacity to put mental attention on whatever we like. If I hold up this paper and I say, put your attention on the paper, and you keep on looking at the paper, after a while, you will not notice that there is a microphone here. You will not even notice the table. The more attention you put on one thing, the less your attention goes to other things. This capacity, inbuilt, an endowment, a gift from the Creator to human beings, enables us to perform that exercise of becoming unaware of the body and yet being aware of the self. How does it operate? You concentrate your attention on the conscious self and gradually become unaware of the body in which the conscious self is included. It's very simple. It looks more complex. It's very simple. If you were to close your eyes in the body and sit within yourself in quiet and contemplate, where are you inside the body? If you consider this is a body is your case, body is your enclosure, body is a house, a mansion, a temple, and you are inside the temple, you are inside the body, and you are behind the eyes, as you feel you are behind the eyes. If somebody feels one is in the tip of the finger, one can start from there and go up to the brain. Wherever you feel you are, if you start contemplating there, where am I? What's going on here? And concentrate your attention on finding out who you are, where are you in the body, after a while you'll find you do not know where your hands are. You can put them like this, you put them like this, you are not aware. To open your eyes, oh, they are like this. What has actually happened is, you have, by concentrating your attention, the thought process in which attention is wrapped up, by putting the thoughts and attention on that particular spot inside the body, inside yourself, where consciousness is operating automatically all the time. It doesn't operate at the time of this exercise. It's always doing it. But just by putting attention on that part and not on the body, you'll find that the first part of the body that you become unaware of are the hands and the feet. And then, as you keep on contemplating more, gradually don't know whether you are lying down or sitting or where the legs are, how the arms are placed, as if you are pulling attention out from the extremities of the body and eventually from the torso, eventually you are not aware where the body is. Incidentally, for those who may not be aware, this is the process of death itself. If you have seen a person dying slowly, you will see this is exactly what happens. Actual death of the physical body takes place precisely the same way. When a person is dying and talking to you, the person loses the consciousness of the extremities first and continues to lose that consciousness and is still speaking to us. He's unaware of the extremities and still speaking to us and pulls the attention back. Ultimately, it's the brain which dies last and the person is dead and can talk no more. Till then, we have time to observe that in actual death, the withdrawal of attention, the withdrawal of life force from the body is following the same route which we would take if we were to artificially concentrate our attention on finding out where are we thinking from? What is this consciousness? Where are all these thoughts coming from? Where is this living being sitting inside the body? This contemplation and concentration of attention on the conscious being creates the same effect. That is why it has been called dying while living. That is what made Paul say, I die daily. And that is what justifies my telling you the story of the parrot. How many of you heard the story of the parrot in Africa? Is there anybody who hasn't heard? Okay, then it bears repetition. Others, please bear with me. I tell the same stories over and over again. So you bear up with me. Once upon a time, it also lightens the heaviness of this talk. It's heavy stuff, so a story like this is a good intermission. Once upon a time, there was a merchant who did import and export business from India with Africa. He used to take Indian textiles and cashews and whatnot to Africa and sell them there. brought some African herbs and maybe other kinds of nuts and into India and sold them there. So this business used to go once a year into Africa to sell Indian things there and bring African things and sell them back in India. That was his business. During his trip to Africa, he used to pass through a very interesting parrot jungle. Something like we have in the Sunken Garden in Florida or some of these places. I don't know if you have been there. There's a parrot jungle. There are a lot of little parakeets. They roam around there. Anybody been to the parrot jungle of Florida? Only Clarence? Well, way before I met Clarence, I had the opportunity of going there to the parrot jungle in the 60s. A friend of mine who worked for Bell Telephone in Washington, D.C., decided to drive me down there. And when we drove there to the parrot jungle, he took us inside. And the parrots were trained to perform various tricks. They could ride bicycles and they could carry umbrellas in their hands and their beaks. Very interesting parrots and parakeets there. And they were trained to say interesting things. What's your name? What's the hurry? You know, as you passed along, they would talk to you. But they mostly talked in their squawky parroty language. What's the name? What's your hurry? No, parroty, twang in their, nasal twang in their voice. But I was going ahead and these other people, my friends, were just falling behind. And one parrot was really very interesting. He was on one side on the branch of a tree. And when I passed, he said, what's the hurry? Just like a human voice. So I stopped. I said, I had never heard a parrot like this. So seeing the parrot talk like this, I began to laugh. And the parrot began to laugh. That's one of the rare laughing parrots I came across. By that time, the rest of my friends had come up and they were surprised to see both of us laughing. So they told me that they were convinced after seeing that I must have been a parrot in my past life. I, of course, corrected them and said, why only in the past life? Why not in this life too? They believed me. So for Christmas that year, they sent me live parrots in cages. They thought they might be my relatives and may keep me company. That's an aside, but parrots have been interesting for me. This Indian merchant who used to go through Africa used to pass through an African parrot jungle. And he liked those parrots flying. So one day he decided to capture one of the parrots, put in a cage and bring him back. So he bought a cage, caught one of the parrots and brought him back to India. In due course, the parrot learned to speak many words and ate very nice green chilies. Whatever is the food of the parrots, green chilies and nice churi. Churi is some kind of a food they make with Indian ghee, Indian clarified butter. And very interesting food. But the parrot began to enjoy his life in that cage in India. And he would jump and laugh and dance and sing and make merry. So after a year, when this merchant went back to Africa, he decided to ask this parrot a question. He said, "Mr. Parrot, you lived with me now for a year, and I am going back to your home country. Do you have any message to send to your folks back home?" And the parrot said, "Yes. Tell them I am enjoying myself in this cage. I eat, drink, dance, sing, and I am making merry here." So the merchant said, "Fine." And he went away. In the course of his visit in Africa, he reached that same forest and met the other parrots. He called them, hollered to them, "Gather ye, I have a message for you from one of your folks I took back to India." So they all collected around, and he told those parrots, "You remember I took one of the parrots from here in a cage back to India? That parrot has sent you a message. And the message is, I am enjoying myself in my cage. I eat, drink, and be merry, and I am singing and dancing, and I am very happy here." On hearing this, one parrot, probably an elderly parrot, sitting on the branch of a tree, got tears in his eyes, and he fell down dead. So the merchant felt very sad that this parrot must be very close to the one I took home. Feeling sad, he came back home, and he told the parrot in his cage, "Look, I told your story and your message, gave your message to the other folks in the parrot jungle in Africa, but a very strange thing happened. One parrot who was sitting close to me on the branch of a tree, when I told him that you are enjoying yourself in your cage and eating, drinking, making merry and singing and dancing, when I said that, the parrot in Africa had tears in his eyes and he fell down dead." When the merchant said this, his own parrot in the cage had tears in his eyes and dropped dead in the cage itself. So the parrot said, the merchant said these two parrots must have been very close to each other, that they could not bear to hear each other's messages. But very saddened by this experience, he opened the cage and threw the dead bird out. As soon as he did that, the parrot woke up and suddenly flew and sat on top of a tree there. And the merchant said, "So you aren't dead after all?" And the parrot said, "No, not only I am not dead, that other parrot in Africa is not dead either. He just sent me a message for you. And the message was, if you want to get out of this cage, die while living." To come back to the same subject again after this intermission. To die while living is the experience of being able to see what consciousness can experience if it is unconscious of the physical body. And not experience theoretically in a dream-like state, in a trance-like state, in a state of theory or a state of speculation, but in practical meditational state in which you are able to hold your attention, your consciousness, in your own self, behind the eyes, in the body, and knowing that you are there, the body is not, what are you? Do you still have a body? Can you still walk about? Can you fly? Can you do many things that you can't do with this body? Are you more real or less real? What is the connection between that and this? Does that have the same life that this body has? Were you alive in that body before you were born in this? Did you have a history in that body? Will you survive in the same body when you die from here? These are the questions that will be answered automatically the moment we enter that experience. If we enter that experience and find that we have a 1,000-year life, we are very young, maybe just spent 200 years in our astral body, in our fine body, and this body's life was just a small intermission, and that we have to go back and complete the rest of our life, and that we recall all that happened in the 200 years before we were born here, the whole perspective on this life changes. It becomes like a pleasant little dream or an unpleasant nightmare or whatever, but not real. It changes. It looks different. And the whole value system upon which our happiness and unhappiness is based in this world changes. So that is why these mystics say, at least once you should experience what it is like to be alive and conscious and not have a body to bother you with. And that is why they recommend that you should practice a meditational technique by which you can access your own self, go to your own self. In this workshop, I'll try to give you a few tips on what can be done to access yourself. So you can try right now. You should try today. Not wait that one day you will experiment with the lecture I gave you. Try today and see if there are any real difficulties coming in the way and how to overcome those difficulties and get some results. I might mention, just for the sake of information, that these mystic adepts have done this over and over again. Their disciples who practiced it have done several times. They belong to all religions. They belong to all nationalities. They belong to all countries of the world. And this is not something confined to any particular person. In order to do it successfully, they find that you have to have a very refined kind of life, because you're dealing now with concentration of attention, very fine quality of thing, not gross matter. Therefore, there are some aids to doing good meditation. And those aids are the kind of diet you take. Take light vegetarian diet with the least impact on your mind about having killed some animal or receiving a killed animal. Light vegetarian diet, eat less, not to load up the stomach so that the attention is down. Very nice, kind, happy life with people as much as you can arrange to the best of your ability. A peaceful environment, a quiet surrounding. If you have these things, it helps to achieve the results faster. If you don't have this, you'll struggle a little longer. And so I am only suggesting that if you have the right environment, you can get results faster. This is what they have recommended, these mystic adepts. If you do manage to become unaware of the body and yet are aware of yourself, one thing you will notice is that you are still able to think in the same way. You are still able to see. You are still able to hear. You are still able to touch. You still have all your sensory functions intact. And you can walk and touch things and see them. In fact, you will see more than you have seen before. What does it mean? It means that what we thought were the sensory functions of the body did not in fact belong to the body. They belong to our finer life force, our finer astral self. And because that astral self was planted in this physical body, these physical organs of the body were able to use those perceptions, the senses of perception, and we dubbed them as senses of physical organs. Like these eyes, take the example of seeing. The function of sight or seeing. You see something, well, we automatically say, we see because we have eyes. And when we say we have eyes, we talk of physical eyes. We forget that if seeing was confined to physical eyes, we could never see anything imaginatively. If seeing was confined to physical eyes, we couldn't see anything in a dream. If seeing was confined to physical eyes, we couldn't see something that has never existed in this world. But yet we all do that. Seeing is different from physical eyes. But because we can see with consciousness, with life force, and the life force is trapped in this body, we are unduly giving the total credit for seeing to these physical eyes. The truth is, the physical eyes do not help us to see more. They help us to see less. They help us to see only that much for which they are constructed. And the rest becomes imaginary, and we don't think it to be real. If we are in fact released from the bondage of this body and can move away from the body for a moment, just step out, and can still see, turn around and see this body through which we saw before, our whole idea of the senses of perception changes. Now you might have heard this expression, astral body. People make such big stories about this. When I came in the 60s, I read some books. Rosicrucians were doing work, other people were doing work on astral body, out-of-body experiences. Most of them were having a lot of problem with those experiences. Connecting with the silver cord and pulling it back and fear of the silver cord breaking. They were making such a big story of this out-of-body experience because they had never really gone within themselves to see consciousness per se. Astral self. The astral self is nothing more than the sense perceptions. The sense perceptions can function independently of physical body. We don't know that. But if we do access the self in the way I suggested, we can see that the sense perceptions function by themselves. And that itself is called the astral body. There is no such thing as astral body. The fact that the sense perceptions of seeing, hearing, touching, tasting, smelling can operate on their own makes that look like and feel like a body. When we are in that state of the sensory perceptions, we find we are still thinking. And we're thinking, how can we do it? What is this? What's going on? All the thoughts that come to us in the physical body continue to come to us in the astral form, which means that except the consciousness of the physical cover, everything else is intact. Whatever life force is packaged together is still intact. Now, what would happen if you were to concentrate your attention on the self and not on the senses in the astral body? Just like you concentrated your attention not on the physical body, but on yourself in the physical body, and you discovered your astral self, what would happen if you concentrated your attention on your own self in the astral body, but not on the senses? If you did that, you would find that the senses, you would become unaware of senses, and yet you would be fully conscious and awake. Your thoughts would still run the same way. That means there is a part of us even more real. There's a self in us which is even more real and persists and survives. And we find that we get a recollection of the self not tangled and webbed by the senses. That self survives and has a longer lifespan than even the astral self. Instead of remembering for 1,000 years I was here, you remember you were here millions of years. You can remember eons having passed. You remember creation after creation having taken place in your very presence, with your memory, not somebody else's suggestion. Your own recollection and your own thinking brain brings you back into a part of creation way beyond this body and way beyond the astral body. And yet that is your own self. You're not gone anywhere outside at all. That's showing that our mental self, in which all thoughts are locked up, is even more real, more in the core of our own self than even the sensory system or the astral self. Of course, when people leave this body and have an out-of-body experience in the astral self, they think, this is it, we are back in heaven. This is where we were born from, we can go back. They think there are only two stages, that this is a very relatively simple universe. We either go back as angels and live in an invisible form, or we come back into this physical coarse world, die and go back again to that world. That's not true. Of course, the majority of people do that. Overwhelming majority of people do that, and we'll see them doing that. But very few do go beyond that and find that the source of consciousness is not confined even to that ethereal astral form. That the source of consciousness is coming from a mental self that has an age in terms of millions of years and not in terms of thousands like the astral self. And that experience comes by the same small, short technique taught by the adepts, which says, access yourself by putting your attention on the conscious self and not on the cover, which at that time were the senses. The same technique works. Anybody can do it. It doesn't end there. The story of self-discovery doesn't end there. It goes further. What would happen if we concentrated our attention purely on the consciousness that is watching and observing the thoughts of the mind? Have you ever watched your thoughts? Have you ever sat quietly and seen the thoughts going in front of you and laughed at it? How stupid they are. People who don't watch their thoughts think themselves very witty and bright. When in meditation they sit quietly and watch their thoughts go by, they can't believe their eyes that they were having such stupid thoughts in their own heads. Because we misidentify ourselves, our souls, we misidentify with the thinking process. We misidentify that our conscious being, our own self, is nothing but those thoughts. We think that the mind that generates those thoughts is our own self. It's very hard to break this. This identification not only goes on, not from birth in this body, it has gone on for millions of years. The whole course of creation and evolution of consciousness has forced us to accept there's no difference between mind and soul. But the mind, the thinking self, and the real self which is able to think are the same thing. They are not. How do we find that out? How can we be so sure that they are not? That's where the
perfect living masters, rarest amongst the rare. You can't find too many of them. I search for them, they're very few. Counted in the hands, fingers in the whole world. They are so few. You can find yogis and swamis and teaching you out-of-body experiences and how to withdraw attention and going to energy centers, the chakras in the body, and even take you to the higher levels of mental universal consciousness. Rarely will you come across a perfect living master, a human being living alive and thinking like us, who is able to not only access himself to that level of the self beyond the mind, but is able to help us to do that. Such a person can tell us from his own experience that the thoughts are being generated by a cover around you. This physical body was a cover. It took you time to find out. The sensory system is a cover. The astral cover, it took you time to find out. Even the thoughts of your mind are a cover. It'll take you time to find out, but you will find out. By what method? The same method. Concentrate your attention. That ability is still there, inbuilt in us. Concentrate your attention, your power to look only at one thing. Put that power on your own self and not on your thoughts. Separate the thoughts. Watch the thoughts go by and sit in the center and see who you are if the thoughts were not there. As you concentrate your attention on yourself and not your thoughts, the thoughts disappear. You become unaware of them. And yet you are more awake than ever before. You are more conscious of who you are than ever before. And you find that you didn't have a life of millions of years. You're immortal. You're always there. That is the nature of ourself. It's permanent. It never had a beginning and a middle and an end. It never had any birth and death. The self was beyond birth and death. But we cannot find it till we cross this limitation of the mind, which created a time frame and created a beginning and an end. So these adepts tell us, if you are willing to go deep enough to find your own conscious self and not one to which you are bound by misidentification, go beyond the mind and find your own conscious self. And then they tell us some very simple things. They say, don't think that what that self will be something that you would suddenly say, oh, that's me. Of course, that's me as you knew it now in the physical body. It's not a new self you're finding now. It's the same self. The same self you started off from the very beginning in the physical body is the same self all the time. It never changed. You're not finding somebody else. How do you find that? Because the same function that would take place in you without the mind is now taking place with the mind, with the senses, with the body. What is that function? What is that experience which you will have, which thoughts cannot create, which thoughts cannot take away at that stage or at this stage? These adepts tell us those experiences are called love, intuition, joy, beauty. They don't come from the senses. They don't come from the body. They don't come from the mind. An intuitive flash of knowledge has never come from any of these. Yet it comes to each one of us, even with all the covers intact. Where does it come from? What part of consciousness creates an experience that you suddenly know something, you're sure about it, there are no thoughts attached to it? In fact, thoughts go against it. Rational thoughts, logical thoughts say, this couldn't be. It's not logical. And something in you is saying, it is so. What part of you is saying that? There are senses, not body, not mind. It is your own conscious self saying that. Intuition is not generated by any other part except that part which we can call the soul or the spirit, the immortal part of us. Love, the ability to identify completely with the object of love, the ability to completely wipe out a separateness, a separate identity, a separate self, and be one with the object of love. That ability of love is only possible through that soul, which is immortal and endless. These adepts tell you, you can go ahead and see it. Don't believe anybody. Don't trust anybody's word on these things. Try it out yourself. And only believe that which you find for yourself. Only accept that teaching of accessing the self which you have accessed to yourself. The rest, keep it on a shelf. Still trying it out. It hasn't come yet. When it'll come, I'll see. You don't have to be, you don't need any blind faith in order to proceed on this basis of self-realization. Well, that looks like the end of the journey. But the highest perfect living masters, rarest of the rare, one in a lifetime that you may find in the whole earth, maybe in the whole cosmos, once in a lifetime, such a perfect living master who has attained a state even beyond that, which is unimaginable, can tell us, you haven't reached the final journey into your own self. Now what's left? We got rid of this notion that we have a physical body. We were just using a body. We got rid of the notion that we are senses. Those were just parts of the astral body. We got rid of the notion that we are thoughts, that we are mind. We got rid of that as the causal body, the mental body. And we found our soul, immortal, no beginning, no end, no life. Where else is the future of this journey? And they tell us, you still have got a cover. What cover do we still have? As a soul, immortal soul. They say the cover is, you think, you've experienced, not think, thinking has been left behind. You experience being a soul. That a soul still carries the cover of individuation, of an entity separate from something else. That separateness has not gone totally. That individuation, that you are individual, there may be other individual souls, has not gone. And that's a cover, it's not real. That if you then put your attention on yourself, which looks an individuated soul, and put your concentrated attention on that soul in a way that you forget this individuation, you reach the final destination of this journey, final as far as we know, when you find that you are the totality of consciousness. Nothing ever existed outside of this consciousness. Everything was at play within a single consciousness. That this whole structure, this whole universe, whole process of creation, whole process of series of creations, reflection after reflection, layer after layer, level after level of consciousness that came into being was arising within a single total consciousness. Nothing was outside of it. That there were no such things as high and low. It was a drama taking place within one totality. That there are no such things as many and one. That many is as illusionary as one. That both are illusions. Because the one and the many create the same individuation, the same separation, and both were unreal. Only rare perfect living masters have had that personal experience and can lead us from where we are with all the covers around us to have the same experience. I have mentioned all this to you so that you don't get tied to the notion that accessing the self only means accessing one step. You should go as far as you can. Why one step? See that there is an astral self more real, more permanent than this body. That there is a causal self, a mental self, more real than both this physical and the astral self. Longer life, more permanent. That there is a spiritual self, a soul, more real, certainly more permanent, totally permanent compared to the mental, the astral, and the physical bodies. And there is a totality of consciousness which has always been there in the same way. The whole show of illusion takes place within that. Who can find this? Any one of you can find this. How? By a simple technique which we will try out. Try out today. The simple technique of accessing our own self within ourselves. In the simplest of ways. No standing upside down. No standing in a river with one leg in and one leg up. None of those difficult sadhanas and yogas. Very simple. Comfortably sitting in your own chair or on the floor or with crossed legs or with legs down. Come in a comfortable state, closing the eyes and going within with a single question, single quest. Who am I? Where am I? What's going on? I want to explore what's happening. What is the relation of me as the conscious being and the cover which I am now examining? The first cover we examine in this body. Second cover we examine is the senses. Third cover we examine is our mind. Fourth cover we examine is our individuated soul. If we can examine these and stay in the center, we'll have found all that there is to find. Now, this is the simple journey. It's a royal road to self-realization. It's the royal road because kings have done it. And kings don't like to take the rough road, you know that. So, when they take the royal road, the smooth road, it's a smooth road. You don't have to take a rickety little jeep and run on it. You can go in a Rolls Royce.
You go in the Rolls Royce of your own consciousness on this. But these are ways which have been given to us in an age. All these techniques and methods have been given to us by masters throughout history. At all times there have been masters who have given us this knowledge and shared with us. But very few of us took advantage. Most of us were keen to convert this knowledge into religion and get more followers and get more organization and get more societies, get more things happening at the very level from where we are trying to get out. The very thing from where we were asked to get out and find the reality, we tried to make the illusion more pretty and more beautiful and more organized. We made a mistake because we couldn't do it. It was very tough. Very few had done it. Even the masters were so rare. So as time goes on, new and new mystic adepts in the different forms, different parts of the earth come. Where do they come? Wherever there is need. Wherever you have seekers, you will find a mystic adept growing there automatically. It's the seekers who create the mystic adept. In fact, it is the drama of the seeker that creates the mystic adept. Wherever this show takes place in such a way that there is need to be fulfilled, as you know, nature fills the vacuum. So when there is great need, nature fills the vacuum. I have this subtle feeling that there is great need in the Western Hemisphere, in North America, this time. The seeking is growing in a big way. And we cannot anymore say, oh, this is only something confined to the East. I come from the East, and now I become of the West, and I can see where these two are meeting. And I can see there's a shift of spiritual seeking going on. And the same kind of spiritual seeking which created so many masters whose names we can keep on counting in history, came in the East and the Middle East. The same spiritual seeking, the same quality of seeking can be seen here. So I have every reason to believe that there will be many spiritual mystics and masters in this part of the world. This axis of spirituality is definitely shifting. You can see results. If I am right, you will see it for me. If I am wrong, I'll be dead and gone. You won't blame me for it. But I see this. I foresee the existence of many perfect spiritual masters. The ones that can fulfill the need of deep seeking of the truth. The deep seeking of who we are. The deep seeking of the self to assert its own truth. That will come up in this. Having given you a long introduction to the subject, I suggest, if you agree with me, that we might try to practice some of these things that I've talked about. Because an ounce of practice is worth more than a pound of lecturing. So I would like to suggest that you, how many of you have done this meditation, any kind of meditation before? Thank you. How many of you have never done any meditation? Thank you. What we are going to do is to sit quietly in the body, take the body as a house, and see if we are consciousness that is in the body, and we look at our own self as consciousness in the body, what happens? That's all. Because there are some perks, what are they called, the side perks? In any business you do, besides the wages you get for it, you get some perks. What are they called, these perks? Some benefits, bonuses, benefits. There are some perks in this business. And those perks are that you may get in the process a lot of questions answered. A lot of your own questions may be answered, which you were looking for to be answered somewhere else. They may get answered right here. You may get answers to some questions which you thought you had never asked anybody. You may get the answer within you. You may see light and color of a type which is a great show. You haven't seen that spectacle before. You may hear sounds of music, not generated by an outside instrument, by the strings of your own consciousness, which are more melodious and more harmonious than any music you have heard outside, and they can be heard inside. All these are the perks of just finding out who we are. So you may get some beautiful, interesting experiences along with the desire to know yourself, be ready for experiencing these other spectacles also that come as a side perk for this activity. If you take this body as a house, as a mansion, you'll find that there is a division at the eye level. The eyes through which we see, when we open our eyes in this physical body and we look out, the consciousness focuses itself through these eyes. Sometimes we try to focus the attention
through the ears to listen to somebody. But only old people, seniors. How many seniors are here? Only for us, four of us. We have to sometimes use our ears to strain. Most people don't do that. They just, if somebody is speaking this side, they want to listen. They don't turn their ears, they turn their eyes. Most people turn their face and eyes to put attention on other people, other things. Therefore, the eyes operate as the opening the windows of one's consciousness or the windows of the soul. The physical eyes are therefore almost a cutoff point between the brain and the thinking processes taking place in the body and the rest of the energy processes taking place in the rest of the body in the torus, in the torso below. So the eyes are a cutoff point, and to start examining your own self, it saves a lot of time and energy if you start from the eye level. If you start from any other level, you will come there eventually. But if you start from the eye level, it will be easier and you will save time. That's why I'm suggesting that with a comfortable position taken on your chairs, comfortable means comfortable not to be distracted by the aches and pains of joints put in the wrong place, or and not so comfortable that you go to sleep. Don't make yourself so comfortable that you go to sleep, but comfortable enough not to distract your attention to any part of the body. Having made yourself comfortable on the body and closing your eyes, withdraw your attention behind the eyes and examine what's happening in your head, behind the eyes, in the middle of the ears, below the head, above the throat, just above the nose and behind. In this area, in this platform, at the eye level, what's going on? That's all you have to examine. In order to examine it more easily than in a wild goose chase, you can start by imagining you're already there. If you imagine, which is very easy because you are there, consciousness is operating from there. So to imagine you are there on a platform behind the eyes and then watching out what's going on makes it easier for you to concentrate your attention on yourself behind the eyes on that platform. So make the platform behind the eyes, sit on it in a comfortable chair of your own choice, because that's an imaginary chair, cost nothing. And or take a beautiful rug from Persia, or from anywhere, Iran, anywhere you like, and spread it out on that special platform behind the eyes. Sit on it, squat on it, and be conscious that you are sitting there. You're conscious that you are in the middle of the head. You're conscious the eyes are in front of you. You're conscious the ears have gone on the side of you. You're conscious you are in the upper part of this body. And while you are consciously sitting on that platform, what's going on? Just look around. Don't try to do anything. Just be there, concentrate on being there, and watch what happens. Close your eyes and begin. There's enough time later on for other things. Forget what happened in the morning, what will happen in the evening. Think of what's happening now, right now, behind the eyes, on that platform. What are you doing? What does it look like? Look around. Just try to concentrate on being behind the eyes. Don't follow anything. Don't follow any faces, any images in front. Watch them and let them go. Like you're watching a TV screen. Stay in the middle. More awake than before, not go to sleep. Behind the eyes, in the center. Count five. One, two, three, 4, 5. Open your eyes. Open your eyes and look this side. Open your eyes and look this side. Anyone like this experience? Good. Anyone found difficulty in staying behind the eyes? Okay. Anyone see any lights or colors in front during the exercise? Okay. Anybody heard any unusual sounds like birds chirping or bells ringing? Okay. Thank you. Made a good start. We'll continue.
with this. Any questions on the technique? Is there something which you haven't understood, which you would like to ask questions on at this time? Please ask now. Yes.
Just sort of energy shifts.
In the beginning that takes place, but later on you'll find that it adjusts as you become, you shift your attention from body to yourself. These become, get regulated again by normal systems. I might mention that in the beginning, you might have a feeling that you are having changes in the saliva, breathing, and there are other things that are affecting your attention. Because attention is drawn to the bodily functions to which you are used to. But as you practice this, and practice on pure consciousness of yourself, and not on the body systems go back to normal automatic reflex actions, and you don't even care for them, and your concentration goes to your conscious self behind the eyes. It's automatically adjusts itself. It doesn't matter. Whichever you felt better is good for you. Keep it there. In fact, it is better for you. I don't want others to start copying that. It's only individual. It's better for you because when you focus out, actually the attention goes out from the eyes. It doesn't remain in. When you focus like that, it tends to collect inside. It goes back to the optic nerve only when you are not looking outside of the eyelids. See, when I say, close your eyes and imagine you are inside, what really happens in the beginning to most of us is, we still keep on seeing or trying to see with these eyes. And we can only see outside these eyes. But since the eyes are shut, the eyelids are in front, we don't see. It's dark. And we think this is inside the head. It's not. Actually, that area which you are seeing and looks like inside the head is actually just outside these eyes. And is not in. But there's no way to know it for a while. There's one way of checking it out. And that is, you practice an estimate of what is the space outside the eyes. And that is by bringing the hands up like this to the eyes. If you do like this, take the hand slowly towards your eyes and touch the eyes. So when you start leaving the eyes, you know what space is outside. You bring them again and then you close your eyes and imagine you are inside. Then again bring the hands up. And very often you'll find that the spot where you think you are inside has already been overtaken by the hands and you already crossed it before you touched the eyes. Which means that space which you thought was inside behind the eyes was actually just outside the eyes. It takes time to correct this error of focusing on our own self inside rather than on assumed self, emotional self outside. The tendency in the beginning is to focus our attention on emotional self. There I am, in the dark, right in front. I can watch. When you can watch your own self in front, that is generally outside the eyes. When you feel you are there, you can't watch anything. You never watch yourself. Even now you can't watch yourself sitting on a chair. You just feel you are there. You know you are there. When you feel you are there and you know you are there, you can't watch yourself because what you watch is in front of you. Then you are behind the eyes. So in the subsequent exercise, try to correct this. If this has crept in, this error has crept in, that you are mistaking the dark spot just outside the eyes as being inside, and correct it by not looking at a little miniature image of yourself. How many of you tried to see a little bit of yourself sitting in front? So you might notice that the little being that you saw sitting in front was not yourself. Who was yourself? The one who was looking at the little being. That's the self. When you look at the little being sitting and doing things which are being told, you should remember that the one looking at the little one is yourself, not the image that you are seeing. If that happens, and you again see a little bit of yourself, pull back to the one who is looking. And that should be behind the eyes. Clear? Any more questions? Yes.
Just at first as well.
It's very normal because you're reaching back, you're pulling out a lot of your own self. It's very normal. Yes, you can cry. Cry it out. Cry it out. At this stage, there is no particular significance. But later on, you will find that there is significance in the colors that you see. At this time, you can have a lot of colors, but mostly based upon combinations of blues and reds. You might also notice when you dream. I don't know how many of you notice that you don't dream in technicolor, full color spectrum. you only dream in monocolor. Did you know that? A majority of our dreams, 90% of our dreams, are in a shade of red or buff or skin colored. All the dreams. The dreams from linking up with day's memory, which goes on into dream sequence as we sleep. The dreams that come from imagining, from fanciful dreams. Even dreams which are pulled up by the subconscious symbolic dreams that come up are mostly monocolor. Only rarely you dream in colors which you can see very sharp, clear yellow and blue together. So most of these will be pinks and reds and purples and so on, and blues. But if you see yellow and red together, a combination of green, yellow and red, it's not an ordinary dream at all. But I am not going to take you into these color schemes right now. But at this time, you may see colors and you may see lights and so on. Those are flashes coming up because you are accumulating your attention behind the two eyes at a single point. These two eyes, which we say are looking out, why do we have two eyes? Why do we have two physical eyes? Just to create the what they call the stereo effect, the three-dimensional effect, that the two eyes should create distance and depth in our vision. Otherwise, there's no need. The cyclops were good enough with their one eye. We have two eyes, but we don't become two people to see. We only have one person to see with two eyes. When you are right now looking with your two eyes, the two optic nerves, the two optic nerves, the two retinas, the two images. The two images are merging and creating a vision for you. Now, when you're looking out, you can even see the hollows, the edges from where you are looking. You can see the tip of your nose, side tips. You can see if you watch closely and you're trying to merge these visions to get the depth. And when you focus here, that goes out of focus. When you focus there, this goes out of focus. You're constantly adapting this focus. But do you realize when you are doing that, as consciousness, you are conscious of using the eyes as if from behind them, from a single point. Where is that single point? That point is the one where I have been suggesting to you to put your attention on, behind the eyes. That has been called the third eye center. That has been called the single real eye. It is that eye to which reference was made. If thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be filled with light. But a light, the magnitude of which you have never seen outside, even by watching the sun. And yet, you will not be startled by the amount of light. Where is it coming from? It's all part of our inner system. It's part of our own perceptive system inside. But we don't concentrate enough there. Did you notice your attention runs through thoughts? You remember a lot of things at this time. If you have forgotten something, you can remember it through meditation. And there's a tendency to sleep. Did anyone have a tendency to sleep? A tendency to sleep, yes, because it comes automatically. Meditation has been prescribed as a cure for insomnia. Those who don't get sleep should try meditation, they'll get sleep. The mind, the whole process which wants to keep our attention outward, rebels against this tendency to now start looking within. It's a reversal of direction we are attempting. A reversal of the normal direction of flow of attention. Let's try once again before the lunch break. Yes. It's good because the way I started off here, it looks like it's a good thing. Most of the time when people want us to do meditation, we rebel against it. And here is something that we're beginning to like. When we begin to like a thing, there's a help that our mind doesn't become a rebel, at least comes along part of the way, is expecting some nice thing, some goodies inside. So that's why we want to be inside. The constraints of time and a workshop do not permit me to continue long sessions of meditation. But when we have meditation sessions, you know we have longer sessions. Anyone attended the meditation sessions we had? Okay. Did you like them? Now the regular meditation sessions where we have long meditation and you get much more experience, when we have them, then I propose not to stop and start counting five, let you continue for a long time and experience. Because once I interrupt, then you come back and you say, what's this? We were already just beginning to flavor some of that inner experience. But right now, this is more of an instructional seminar or a workshop to see how we should do it.
I have been saying during the session that do not follow any pattern in front. Did you hear me say that? Because if lights come and patterns come in front and you don't follow, more will come. If you follow, they'll stop. Similarly, if you hear some sound, some melody, and you don't follow it, more will come. If you follow it, it'll stop. Why is that? The reason is simple. It's coming because you are in the center. When you start following it, you move from the center, it stops. You don't realize it's not coming because you are following it. It's coming because you are pulling back to the center. It is by centering to your own self, the consciousness where it belongs in the wakeful state, that these experiences come. So I try to make this as simple and commonsensical as possible. But if you have any problems or questions, please interrupt me and always ask, so that we move along. We don't stop anyways. This is not a cult. This is not a ritual. This is not something being practiced for the sake of any esoteric or some strange spiritual benefits. This is a simple, commonsensical approach to knowing oneself in one's reality, as experienced by perfect mystic adepts who saw it and shared their joy and happiness of finding themselves with us. It's very simple. Let's try it again. Close your eyes. This time, if you hear any sound, don't move from the center, but listen to it attentively from the center. Put your ear on a sound if you hear any, attentively. Close till I count five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Open your eyes and look this side. Open your eyes. Better? Okay. Worse? Okay. Questions? No. No. It's not supposed to have. It's not based upon suggestion. Hypnotism is based upon suggestion. But if you create a sequence of experiences based upon suggestion, you have to soon enough leave them behind. So it is not based upon hypnotism. You can mix up suggestion with the experience going on. But very soon, if you stay awake and do not fall into a sleep state, you will not be under any hypnotic spell. But if you go into a trance state or sleep state, then you can have a hypnotic suggestion. But the intention in this practice is to keep fully awake, not get into that state. Yes?
Just that sometimes in my meditation at home, which I'm now trying very hard to do, and which I've done in the past, I feel if I have a few main moments, maybe a few seconds of quiet and the clear, quiet light that I'm doing well, I know what is that?
Oh, yes, if you get a few moments, it's good enough. Absolutely. Yes, if you get a few moments of clear concentration of yourself and get the experience of who you are, it's good enough. You don't need an hour's experience. A few moments of clear experience of being there without knowing where the body is, it's good enough. If you can get that, you got what you were expecting. Yes?
Yes, Ishwar, do you personally meditate every day?
I try.
When you do that...
It's very hard.
Yes.
I'm sharing with you.
When you do that...
Does anybody else agree with me? Oh, I'm not alone. Thank you.
Do you experience every time the things you describe as thought meditation in terms of the various levels going straight to the heart and all of that, do you personally experience that every time?
If I described everything exactly as I experienced, nobody would call me a parrot. The fact I'm called a parrot means I repeat like a parrot some things. Which things I describe like a parrot and which things I personally see, I leave to your guesswork. And you can make some intelligent guessworks in due course. Okay? Thank you. Any other question? Yes.
To feel the borders of my face, and then when I feel the borders of my face, I can draw my attention inward. And it helps me much better rather than focusing immediately on the center of my head.
Right.
Slowly, slowly, try and focus.
That's good. That's good. Follow that. Some people have found it useful to follow the consciousness, the awareness of the border of their face, consciousness of their head, especially those who have had headaches and so on. You know, they feel their temples are there. Sometimes if they have problems, then the temples and the head can be experienced as experience of the feeling that the head is there, and then they can locate themselves inside. But it takes time to go within. Some people have tried another method which has worked, and that is they feel they are scattered all over the body, maybe in the heart. They can't feel exactly that they are behind the eyes. They are all over the body. So what I recommend to them is to imagine that this is a six-story house with all the chakras being different stories, levels of the, and elevator is going down the spine. You come on the elevator at the sixth floor, open the door, jump out just behind the eyes from the spine. All these techniques are designed to bring our attention from wherever it is, somehow to the wakeful point behind the eyes, and they work.
Follow.
You can follow whichever one you like.
We can follow the attention slowly and bring it up.
Right. Another way, some people have had difficulty how to really jump inside. Another technique that works is that you can put a palm of your hand on one side like this and imagine you are sitting on that palm. Can you do that? Just stretch your palm out like this, or in front or on top. You can't see it. You are sitting on your own hand. Can you feel you're sitting on your own hand? Can you see it? Feel it? Then with your eyes closed, bring the hand right in front of the eyes, touch the eyes, and jump in. Many techniques. The point is, what are we trying to achieve is somehow put the attention somewhere and bring it back there. And since we are used to putting attention outside, some of these techniques help. Use whichever helps you. Use whichever. Eventually you will find that what helps is the awareness that you are where you are, not where you are looking at. The difficulty is we try to feel we are where we are looking at, not where we are. Even if it is very close, we feel we are right there. We can be very close, within an inch, within a centimeter, within a millimeter of where we are. So there we are, and we are just a millimeter behind. Because we want to focus. We have been taught like this. We don't blame ourselves. We have been taught like this, to focus our attention. We've never been taught to withdraw our attention. Big difference. Even the meditational techniques teach us how to focus attention. Even education teaches us how to focus attention. Even duties and obligations of life teach us how to focus attention. Put your attention on this thing means take it away from yourself. Put it on something. So when the attention is supposed to be focused on something, the process of focusing is not the same as the process of withdrawing it to the point from where it is focused. Now what I am trying to suggest in this technique is to withdraw attention to where it is focusing from. It's a new thing. But with practice, you'll come to know it. With practice, you'll find withdrawal of attention comes by being with yourself. Wherever you are, it hardly matters. Supposing you say you are not behind the eyes, doesn't matter. You withdraw where you are. You'll find by strange coincidence that when you withdraw your attention to wherever you feel you are a conscious being, you will eventually find that you end up in the wakeful physical state behind the eyes. Not in other states. In the dream state, you won't feel you are behind the eyes. You'll be right down below in the throat. In the super state of astral experiences and flying in the sky, you won't feel you are behind the eyes. You'll feel you are above somewhere in the forehead. It is only in the physical wakeful state that the feeling comes that we are operating as conscious beings from a point behind the eyes, somewhere like a triangular path where the eyes form the two ends, the third edge, the third corner is at the third eye center behind the eyes. But it comes by practice. Yes? Does anybody have this problem of thoughts coming in and bothering us during this? Anybody who has that? Oh, so many. We have to find a way out. The yogis and the sadhus and the rishis and maharishis and mystics, they all found a single way of taking care of this problem of thoughts. And that is, if these thoughts that come involuntarily, even when we don't like it, even when I shout here, don't think, Who cares? Thoughts come anyway. The solution to that is not to stop thinking. As I gave you the story last night, you can't stop thinking. The solution is put some well-considered, innocuous, harmless, useful thoughts in place of the thoughts that are coming. And this process is called mantra. That you adopt certain words which have no meaning, no association of ideas with anything that is happening around you outside. If they have an association, it is an association with an inner experience. A mantra was coined. These meditators coined up different mantras or these holy words of repetition, not because they had magical properties of their own, but because they had the great magic that when you repeated them, they could hold your attention to those words and squeeze out some of the thoughts that came involuntarily. So when we have this exercise continued after lunch now, we'll use mantras and take care of that problem.